Hallelujah. It's been quite a week. A lot of attacks. The enemy's throwing those fiery darts left and right. And I'm talking about me. Not you guys. You have to answer for yourself right now. It's been a tough week. Although we met Wednesday night, and there was a beautiful word given on Wednesday night prayer. To encourage me is one of them, you know, to do the will of God and just, you know, and I prayed about it. Lord, do you still want me to pastor here? I have asked the Lord that. And the Lord says, you just keep preaching my word. And you just do what I tell you to do. You don't worry about what's going on out there. That's my job. So, and then Wednesday comes and she gives the word that was confirmation to that, so I have to shut my mouth. Because we get into our flesh, and then I hear this song this morning, do I trust in his, I trust in your word. And I'm realizing, do we really trust in the word of the Lord? In all of our lives, in all everything we do. You know, it's amazing. I've been attacked. Bringing this teaching out is amazing about the spirits. They don't want this out. I mean, even Friday, I got into it with one of the managers. I didn't get into it. I chewed him out. And he took a long walk, and I had to pull him into the office and apologize to him with a humble spirit. And he said, I took a long walk, and I was just thinking, man, that's not Blaine's character. That's not who Blaine is. He was befuddled by me. And no, I didn't say nothing bad or nothing. I just really got on to him, and that's not who I am. And I started realizing that. So I took him in, and I really did apologize from the bottom of my heart. And I asked him to forgive me, and he did. And it's just like, man, Lord, these attacks, it's all over the place. So last night I was listening to some stuff, and the Lord just, you know, I just repented. Said, Lord, you know, I want to be more right to please you, and I want to be less of Blaine. Even out at the baseball field or at a soccer game or at work or at church, it's not about me, it's about Jesus. And I think we're forgetting who it's about. We're starting to throw it in. And like I was saying this morning, it's God first in my life. That's my wife. She will not come before God. If she tries to make a decision for me to be before God, I will walk. I'm going to tell you that. It's God first in my life. And I have to be more like that today than I've ever been. I have to put him first in everything I do. And I want to be more humble in my life. And I want to be more changed. And that's what I ask him. Change me. Help me to be more faithful to you. Change me to be more like your son, Jesus. It says in there, to walk as he walked. To walk as he walked. And then we play a song, or we trust in his word. If we trust in his word, we'd walk more like he walked, in more of a place of humility. You know, and then the Lord was speaking to me about, for 3 years, I brought the son of perdition to walk with me. He ministered. He did things. And I never cast him out. I even washed his feet. And I was just sitting there going like, oh, Lord, man. I'm the first one to throw a stone. I have to say, forgive me. He goes, what about Peter? 3 years, he saw and he done things and he worked with people and he done things, but yet he was the first one to deny me and curse me. I still loved him as much as I love you. And I knew that I had a plan for him in the future. That's why I don't cast him out. There's always a will of God. God is a sovereignty God. He knows what he's doing. I don't all the time, even though I will ask. He doesn't tell me every time. But I know he spoke to me. You keep your eyes on me and stop looking out and just do what I tell you to do. If I tell you to preach, you preach. If I tell you to teach, you teach. You do what I tell you to do and you keep your eyes on me. Because when I stand before God and God alone, each one of you are not going to be there telling him. It's going to be me and him alone. And I want him to say, good and thou faithful servant, enter into my kingdom. Because you have done what I have told you to do. Man, I tell you, the attacks have been very strong. I On social media, some people don't think pastors should be. There's many pastors on social media. It's one way to get the word of God out, the gospel. That's what I put on there. You guys see it. It's not too much Falmouth. Once in a while you see a picture of Falmouth. Most of the time it's all about the word. I'm on a whole bunch of different ones, and I'm always putting preach the gospel. I'm on one where there's a lot of people from work is on that one. I just want to preach the gospel. I have followers that come. A lot of times I don't follow people. They just follow. You know, they listen to what I have to say. I've gone to places where you don't think they're listening to the preaching, but they'll say, oh, I'm listening to it, and I listen to what you say, and it's like, I thank you for it. And I'm like, wow, I didn't even know you were doing that. Well, I got this one thing I want to read from you. Here's how the devil is trying to sidestep. I want to read some. I usually don't bring my cell phone in here because I don't like to, but I wanted to read this to you this morning. I had this follower, don't know who it was. I don't know who she is. But her name is Kayla. And I won't say her last name because I don't know who she is. And I said, this for once it was my spirit. I said, well, just hit follow. I go, I don't usually do that. I don't know the people. There's too many people following. I go, I don't care who follows me. I don't care who I follow because they're going to get Jesus. So I get this, and she sent me a message. A message. It says this. Greetings, honey. I am the seventh generation of Luna witches that has been practicing in Seattle for the past 25 years. I specialize in all aspects, love, marriage, finance, career, family, car rest, I don't even know what that means, number, ology, etc. DM me for any questions or concerns you may have. She goes, here is a list of things I do. My readings, love readings, past, present, future readings. Isn't it funny that I'm going to be teaching on this? Witches and stuff, we're not to follow. I get this. And it goes, here, look at this. Past, present, future readings, past lovers readings, soulmate readings, twin flame readings, I have no clue, psychic readings, crystals and ball readings, life readings, tarot card readings. This woman is filled with the devil. My spells, love spells, bring back X spells. Okay. Adore my spells, renewing spells. She is putting spells on people, curses. Financial spells, lust spells. These are the spirits that we're talking about. And I will be talking about lust spells, fruitful spells, self-love spells, trust spells, binding spells. And many more custom spells also. Spiritual cleansing, aurora cleansing, chakra, I don't know what that means, cleansing, chakra alignment. I should look that word up, but I didn't care to. I really don't. Unless it's going to line up with what I'm teaching. I also do candle works and sell special healing candles. I know there's only one that heals, and it's Jesus the Christ. It's not a candle can't heal you. DM me, what's up? Me for a brighter tomorrow. She gives me her phone number. So I did. I messaged her. I said, I'm sorry to hear this. I am a pastor for the living Most High Jesus Christ. So if you need to know more about Christ and be delivered from this stuff, I am here. That's what I DM'd her. You need to know Jesus. You need to be set free. I pray that God sends the Holy Spirit into that woman's life and deliver from the witches that she says she is. Deliver from the demonic spirit that has taken her over. She texted the wrong person. Because I ain't there for no lust spirit, no other spirit. You're going to get Jesus Christ. And I wonder what happened when she read that. Because when she had to say Jesus Christ, everything that she believed in had to go away. Because there's power in the name of Jesus, amen? There's power in Christ. See, we're getting attacked. Trying to throw that stuff at me. While we're speaking about the evil spirits. It's amazing when you bring up the enemy. He doesn't want to be known. He doesn't want the Christians to know who he really is. He wants you to sit there and be comfortable. He wants you to sit there and say that your life's okay. Well, your life isn't okay if it's not walking as he walked. If you're not walking like Jesus in all your aspects. If he tells you to be humble and you're not humble, you're not walking like Jesus. If you have wrath, if you have anger, if you have a bad mouth, if you have anything like that, it's not of God. You're not walking as Christ. Well, that's hard preaching. That's truth. Jesus says to walk even as I have walked. He says, if you say you abide in me in 2:6, if you say that you abide in me, him ought himself to walk even as he walked. How did Jesus walk? Go through the Gospels. He was spit on. He was slapped on. He was called the devil. Many of the occasions he could have fired back. Many of them. Even into the when he was talking to Pontius Pilate, he didn't even answer him. Until Pontius Pilate said to him, do you not know that I have the power to crucify you? And Jesus finally spoke and said, you have no power over me unless it was given to you from above. You don't think that man was shaking in his boots then? When the guy you think you're going to crucify, you said you can't do it unless it was given unto you. I want you to think about that. God is still in control. He is a sovereign God. We worship a God who knows what he's doing. Even though your life doesn't think it's lined up with it, he has a plan. And it will come to fruition. Amen? He will do what he wants to do in your life. I want you to know that this morning. These attacks, that's when we pick up the shield of faith. It's supposed to quench all the fiery darts. Well, it does if we truly pick up the shield of faith. If we pick that faith up and we trust in him and in his word and we walk as he walked and we do as he tells us to do, we pick that shield up no matter what the enemy fires at you, it says in Ephesians chapter 6. It says it quenches all the fiery darts. That means he has fiery darts, just like this girl. She's putting spells on people. If they're not covered by the blood of Jesus, those spells are going out because they're demonic. We'll be reading about some of that stuff. I just want you to know, this isn't a game. Stick with Jesus Christ and be covered with the blood of Christ and being filled with his Holy Spirit full. Amen? He's the one that will guide you and lead you if you listen. Get off of yourself and get back to Jesus because it's all about who?
Jesus.
It's all about Jesus. Let's turn to Ephesians chapter 6. I'm going to start this again so we can kind of break down a little bit before we get into all the stuff we're going to be getting into. Am I still good enough? Can you hear me out there? Shelby, you can hear me okay? Am I going too fast? Okay. Someone point at me because you know me, I'll start rattling and I'll get excited and the hyperness comes out of me and just look at me and go like this. Slow me down. I don't get offended by that. I've had it happen more than once. It's like, hey, you know, if more people would get on fire for Jesus and get excited, we'd have a house full of people, amen? See, this is what I was talking about this morning. The enemy is at work, and not just the unbelievers. He's using them as little pawns. But he's at work within the Christians by putting so much stuff in their life that they're busy. They can't be here, they can't do that, can't do this. It always has something else going on that's more important than coming to the house of God. To me, this is the most important thing, is being in the house of God. This is where you get encouraged, people. This is where you get lifted up. This is where you get edified. And if you need healing, he heals you. If you need spiritual healing, he does that. If you need physical touch, he physically touches you. Most of it's mental, a sound mind. That's what we. How many of us need a better sound mind in here? Yeah. God promises that's his word. Why don't we have it? That's a question. That wasn't a statement. Why do we have it? If the word says it, then we need to believe it. That every man be a liar, but God isn't. When he speaks it, it will come to truth. What God says is truth because it's his word. Amen? Ephesians chapter 6. Everybody knows this verse. I'm just going to jump to 10, but I'm only going to say this. It says, listen, finally, my brother, be strong in who? The Lord. And in the power of his might. Right? In whose power? His power. Not Blaine's power, not the pastor's power. Nobody else but in his power. In his power. Look at verse 11. Put on the whole armor of God that ye may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. We are to do what? To put on his armor that we might stand. No matter what the devil throws at you, if you're in his might, you're in his power, you will quench those fiery darts. It's when we get unto our own selves, is when the enemy knocks us down. And he starts putting a wedge between things. And he starts putting problems up here, and he starts thinking about all kinds of things. And like, oh, the church ain't full like it's supposed to, and he starts working on you, the enemy, like, well, maybe you should quit. No, God tells me not to quit. You see what I'm saying? God's called you to preach the gospel. You preach the gospel. You don't worry about what's going out there. I had to get a little reprimanded from the Lord. It's okay. If God wants to correct me, he's God. I just take it and then ask forgiveness. But he's God. So Ephesians chapter 6, I mean verse 12, chapter 6, it says, for we wrestle not against... Hey, look at people. We're not wrestling against each other. You might think it's a brother or sister, a child, a loved one. We're not wrestling against them. We wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against what? Principalities. Against powers. Against the rulers of darkness. I just read you the rulers of darkness. From someone sending me a message. I feel like calling that number and preaching Jesus Christ and watch the devils just flee out of that person. The Lord tells me I will. And then it goes on here, says darkness of this world. Listen, rulers of darkness of this world against spiritual wickedness in high places. Paul is letting me know what we're wrestling against. That wrestling word. It means to struggle, to fight, to combat. It doesn't mean that you're to sit there and lay down or sit in a pew. It means hand-to-hand combat. I was a wrestler in high school. In college, I was trying out after I played football. I know what it's like to be hand-to-hand. This is what Paul's saying. It's wrestling. We are in a battle. Against not you and me, but against the spiritual wickedness that's in the heavenly places. Against the principalities, against the powers. We are in a fight, beloved. But we are to stand in his might and in his power. We are to put his armor on. Amen? So when I get into this, I'm going to break this down a little bit so we understand. Before we get back into all the different kinds of spirits and where they come from and stuff, I want to break it down and go easy. Because this is a new topic to a lot of people. A lot of people haven't gone to church and heard about the evilness. Look, I'm not edifying Satan at all. I'm giving you power against him, which is the name of Jesus Christ. But I want you to understand who your enemy is, the one that comes to kill and steal and destroy. This is the same one that came to Eve. He's coming to you. He's sending those demonic spirits out. They're here to destroy your life. They're here to take you off the path of righteousness. They did it with Jesus. Do you think you're better than Jesus? If Satan didn't go to, if Satan went to Jesus, I guarantee you he's sending his cohorts to come to you. He tried to take Jesus off the path. Bow down and worship me and I'll give you all of this. I'll give you the money. I'll give you the happiness. I'll give you all the nations will be under you. But bow down and worship me. Nah, Jesus says there's only one I'm going to worship. And that's God and God alone. He tests him in his abilities and in his powers because we have powers in the name of Jesus Christ. We walk in the resurrection life. Amen? He tested that in Jesus. Well, you haven't eaten for 40 days. Maybe you're a little hungry. You guys go 24 hours, you act like you're dying. Talked to a girl yesterday in Lassen's. I said, how you doing? She goes, not too good, I'm hungry. No, she goes, I'm starving. I go, ma'am, it's not the right word to use. You're not starving, you're just hungry. There's a big difference. And she just kind of smiled like, yeah, I think there is. If you were starving, you would know the difference. See, the enemy is attacking us in everything that we have. In everything, your money, your finances, your marriages, your children, in everything, your job, your work. He's there to put anything he can in front of you to get your eyes off of Jesus. And sometimes it's subtle. Sometimes it's lust. Sometimes it's money. Sometimes it's this. He will continue to do it until the day that God takes you away. That's why we're to walk as Jesus walked and understand when the enemy comes and faces you and use the word of God against him as Jesus did. If we really truly understand Jesus' first word, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceedeth out of God's mouth. If we truly understand that, that song, that's what it's talking about. I put my trust in his word. Jesus did it right there and he showed us what happens. Then after he gives him all these three sayings, it said what? The devil fleed. Remember what it says in James 4:7? Submit thyself unto God and resist the devil and he shall flee. The next verse says, draw nigh unto me and I draw nigh unto you. Cleanse your hands, you sinners, and purify your hearts, you double-minded. Why? Because a double-minded is what? Emma was reading it to me this morning. On those days, she was reading James 1. A double-minded is what? Unstable in all of his ways. If you ask and amiss, you will not receive. If you ask and not believe, you're not going to get it. We're using the name of Jesus, but yet we turn to something else as soon as you use it. Where's our trust in Jesus today? It's his word and his word alone. I feel like I'm preaching today. I've got to get back to the word. But it's on my heart that I know what I'm fighting against. I've done it this week, and I think there's more out here that's battling, amen? Hey, every one of us has probably been attacked this week, physically, mentally, spiritually, but somewhere we've been attacked. Can I get amen on that one? Yeah. All right, so I talked about wrestling. It means struggles to fight against principalities. It says against principalities. Principalities means chief rulers. That's what that word means, chief rulers. Beginning of the first rank in order in their own kingdom. The word actually in Greek is arche, where we get architect. They're a designer. They're the first ones to design it. They're first. They're the ranks. They have ranks. You have the one there that we call Lucifer, the head of all. It says in Revelation, the red dragon himself drew one-third of them out with his tail. You have different ranks than God. You have Michael, you have Gabriel, you have different ones. They're in different positions. You have ranks in his body. You have pastors, evangelists, you have prophets, you have different ones. It talks about the fivefolds of the in Ephesians. See, there's always a rank, but here they have their ranks too. Hope, but we have hope in Jesus. Amen? No matter what these principalities are, listen to this. Ephesians 1:21 says this, far above all principalities and power and might and dominion, that every name that name, not only in this world, but also in the which one to come, is Jesus. Doesn't it say that every knee will bow, which is in heaven, which is in earth, and which is under the earth? Every tongue shall confess that Jesus Christ is the Lord. These principalities, these powers, and all this wickedness and rulers and stuff will confess that he is the Lord. Amen? That's what it's talking about. We have hope. We have hope in Jesus. And we got to believe that. The next one was powers. I won't pronounce it in Greek because I have a hard enough time in English sometimes. It's a big word. But powers means this. Authorities derived from the were constituted by above, delegated influence. That's what power means. Authority, jurisdiction, liberty, right, strength. There are powers of intellectual, powers of physical, power of directed, collective power. See, they think they have power over a believer. This person that wrote this thing, I can pass a cell, I can give you this, I can put this blessing on you with all these things that you want to have. They have no power over you, beloved brother and sisters in Christ. Nothing can get through that blood. Amen? But the word especially refers to the spiritual high powers in the unseen world. Whether good or bad, they were created by the Lord. He is ahead of them all. He is ahead of them all. Colossians 1:16 says this, "For by him, Jesus Christ, were all things created that are in heaven and that are in the earth, visible and invisible." That means there's invisible stuff around us. You hear what I'm saying? There's invisible stuff. Whether they be thrones, there's your ranks, dominions, or principalities, or powers, all things were created by him and for him. Colossians 2:10 says this, "And you are completed in him." Amen, amen, I'm completed in him. "Which is the head of all principalities and powers." I am completed in him. I was reading and watching a little thing about Balak and Balaam. Who knows that little story about Balaam and the donkey? And Balak wanted him to curse the children of Israel, because they were going to go through Moab. And we'll talk about Moab in a couple of weeks coming down, and who he came from and what is Moab. And the they worship Moloch, comes from Moab, and they would sacrifice children to him. We'll get to that stuff. But he is talking about this. And he wanted him. This guy spoke the word of God, and he did it. And God did speak to him. You can read it in Numbers 21, 22, and 23, right around there. And he did speak to him, Balaam. But Balaam had a wicked heart because he was using the word of God for gain. We see this today. We use the word of God for gain, don't we? To claim it and name it stuff. And the prince, I mean, all this stuff that they have in this church, you know, you shall be in prosperity. That's not the gospel of Jesus Christ. It's not. But that's all coming from the devils and the enemy trying to get you off the track. Balaam was doing the same thing. And God said, "You are only going to say what I tell you to say." And the king kept trying to give him riches and riches and riches. And he kept denying them. And finally, Balaam was going to go to him, even though God told him to go. But Balaam in his heart had a different reason of going, because he knew he was going to get a lot of money. So what happened on the way to the journey is donkey started to act up. Why did his donkey act up? Because he saw the unseen. And what was unseen, there was, says, an angel standing in the way with a drawn sword. Balaam's eyes wasn't open, but the donkey saw it. And he kept beating the donkey. And then finally, they went down a narrow path, and the angel appeared in front of them again. And the donkey took him and crushed him up against the wall. Guess what he did? He got off of that donkey and he beat his donkey. Started calling it dumb, and the donkey's mouth was open, it said. And the donkey looked at him and said, "Have I ever done anything to you since the day I was here for you?" And then the donkey had to tell him, "Look, you have been killed." And then God opened his eyes so he could see the unseen world, and there that angel was in front of him. And then he said, "You go, and you only say what I say, and you do what I say." And then Balaam went there, and he goes, "I can't curse these people because God has blessed them." And you can read the rest of the story. He sacrificed on high places. See, in there, they would go to their different gods, because that's where they would put them, on high places. So first the king takes them to this. A lot of people don't even believe this when they read it. But he took them over to this high place. He said, "Okay, build me 7 altars." And he took 7 bulls and 7 rams, and he sacrificed them, Balaam did. He said, "I'll go see what God tells me." God says, "You do what I tell you." He did that 3 different places. And he blessed the children of Israel. He didn't curse them, because he says, "I can't curse them that God has blessed. I want you to grab that. You cannot be cursed because you are blessed of God if you're his child. The enemy has no rule over it because you have power over him by the name of Jesus. I want you to walk out of here with a puffed up chest, not in pride, but knowing who you are as a son of the Most High God. No matter what kind of attacks we had this week, God is more powerful. Amen? I know that was a little sideways, but there was something in there because I was getting to the unseen. There's more that's around us right now that's real than me and you standing before us. There are holy angels that camp around us right here. They're here to protect us. There's a hedge of protection around us from the Most Holy God. And it's real. Remember Elijah when his servant eyes were open and he saw all the chariots of fire and all the angels? I was thinking if one angel can kill 186 in one night and all these chariots of fire, and he says, why do you even worry? What's out there is greater than what's down there. Remember, what's in your life is not greater than what's in him. You don't see what's going around you, but there's a world around you that you can't see. It's demonic, and then there's the other side, which we believe in, the good side, the holy angels, the Holy Spirit, which is this. Okay? And then it goes on to say, the rulers of darkness of this world. Well, that's a key thing right there. The rulers of darkness of this world. In Greek, it's, never mind. The rulers of the world, it's a long word to say in Greek. The world, the rulers of the world, the emperors of darkness of the state of things. Number one, here is the limitation of Satan's dominion. Is expressed, rulers of darkness of this world. Only this world. He has no right, but he is of this world. We know that. He went to Eve. He went to Jesus. And guess who else he's trying to tempt and get off the path of righteousness with his little cohorts and everything. He's trying. But we have Jesus. We have the power in us. We have the light. Remember, the other day I was asked, in a meeting, I was the first one in there, and it was dark in there. And someone asked me, you're sitting in the dark. I said, no, I'm the light in this dark. And he just looked at me and goes, you're always so positive. Well, because I am the light in this dark. Amen? It can't comprehend. Darkness can't comprehend light. Take your light there. Take your light there. Amen? Anyways, John 14:30 says this. John 14:30. Hereafter, I will not talk much with you. The prince of this world, the prince of this world cometh and has nothing in me or me. How about you? Does he have anything to do with you? See, Jesus called him the prince of this world. He is the ruler only of this world right now. But we serve a king of kings and the Lord of lords. Amen. We serve him, Jesus the Christ, the great I am. Remember, he's your door. He's your gate. He's your advocate. He's the bishop of your soul. He is the author of your faith, which we pick up that quenches these fiery darts. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Satan is called the ruler of this world. 2 Corinthians 4, verse 4. In whom the God of this world has blinded the minds of them which believe not. Whose eyes is he blinding? Come on now. Whose eyes is he believing? It said in this verse. Those that believe not. The lady that texts me this believes not. Her eyes are blinded. She needs her eyes opened by the power that's in Jesus Christ. Amen. We're going to pray for Kayla. We're going to pray that God delivers this person. I pray I'll get a message someday that Jesus has set her free so we can give that testimony. It says, blind eyes and believe not, lest the light of the glorious gospel of Jesus Christ, who is in the image of God, should shine unto them. He is termed the God of this age. Talking about Satan, the little g, the God of this age. He is the prince of this world. And he has no right over me or you. But Jesus used the same idea in John 12:31. Now is the judgment of this world. Now shall the prince of this world be cast out. Hallelujah. Amen. John 14:30. Hereafter I will not talk with much with you, for the prince of this world cometh, and he has nothing in me. Does he have anything in you? He has nothing in me. He's tried. But I pray for that hedge to be thick and tall. I pray it to be high. I pray it to be below. Father, put that hedge around each one of us. Put it around this little body here. Put it around our children. Put it around the people we love. Give those holy angels charge about us. Amen? Because he has no right over you. Because we're bought with a price. And that price was blood. It was on Calvary. He shed that blood for you, and he bought you with a price, and he filled you with his spirit, not the unholy spirit. It says in 1 Corinthians 3:16, you are the temple of God, and the spirit of God dwelleth in you. If any man defiles the temple, him, it says, him God shall destroy, for the temple of God is holy. And he asked a question, as I asked, which temple are you? See, I know the temple of that young lady, but the temple I am is of God, because he dwells in me, amen? Spiritual wickedness. The spiritual things of wickedness, or the spiritualities of wickedness, highly refined and sublime evil. Spirit of wickedness. We say this, a wicked man, a wicked deed, wicked ways, wicked lives, wicked heart, wicked design, wicked works. That's a wicked job over there. That's a wicked person over there. That's a wicked thing over there, that stuff. Oh, I wouldn't want that job. That's of the enemy. It's all of wickedness. Against spiritual wickedness, margin. Or wicked spirits, literally the spiritual things of wickedness, but all the illusion of undoubtedly the evil spirits and to their influences on earth. One, as to their position. Two, their office. Three, their essence. Four, their character. Five, a conflict with unseen spiritual enemies led to by a crafty and subtile commander, that you may be able to withstand against the wiles of the devil. I said that because this is their position. This is their way, their ranks. They all have different little things they got to do. If they know that you have a problem with lust, he's going to send the spirit of lust into your life. If you have a problem with some other kind of spiritual thing, if it's say drugs, he's going to throw that at you. If it's alcohol, that spirit of alcoholism is going to come to your house. If you do not stand against it, against the wells of the devil by the power that's in Jesus Christ. I was talking to someone the other day, and they were talking about something, and I actually said to her this morning too. They would say, well, I get this problem, I got that problem, and you know you got this. And I said, well, what are you saved from? My Bible says you're saved. What were you saved from? You were delivered from that stuff at the cross. You were delivered from alcohol. You were delivered from pornography. You were delivered from that stuff. What were you saved from? You said, I'm saved. What is it you saved from? Did he not deliver you, or did he? Say, well, I'll just leave that one on you to see how you walk. No. Jesus says you are a new creature. He cleansed you, and he washed you, and he clothed you, and he put you on a solid rock. He says you are a new creature in me. You're not an old creature that passed away. But yet we struggle with these things, and we blame it on everything else. We blame it on the church. We blame it on the pastor. We blame it on our children. We blame it on the guy next door. But we never look here. We never look inside and said, I'm the problem, because I'm not having faith in Jesus. I'm not trusting his word. He says it, I have to believe it. Do you guys follow me today? Because what I'm talking about is a real thing. And it's going to happen, and it is happening in every one of our lives, because he wants to get you down.
It is the prince of darkness that contends, using falsehood and wicked as his instrument. That's what he does. The enemy, the next, the enemies are spiritual in their nature. Not only are they crafty and intelligent, but they're invisible, active, unwary. The wicked spirits, they are themselves wicked. They're wicked. These spirits are not nothing but wicked. I want to get that through. They would make other wicked. They employ the most wicked means. Listen, our lesson here for us to do this. Watch. Pray. Resist. Stand fast. That's what we're to do. 1 Peter 5:8 says, be sober and vigilant. That word means be watchful. Be alert. That's what we're to be. Why? Because it says the devil walketh around like a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour. This is real stuff I'm talking about. I am not glorifying Satan. He's already has his place. I rebuke him and his cohorts and all the demons and the wicked spirits and all the other spirits we'll talk about in the name of Jesus Christ. But they're real people. You wonder why you're fighting. You wonder why you're having problems. Get back right with Jesus and rebuke them out of your life. Why do you think we have to bring every thought into captivity to the obedience of Jesus the Christ? You need to bring every thought into captivity. Every high thing that comes against the wisdom of God. This beautiful word. Go back to this. That's your life. Victory. Victory. Listen, we have victory certain to the faithful soldiers in Christ. We have victory. Number one, we have victory over the world. Remember that. You have victory over the world. Number two, you have victory over sin. It's okay to say hallelujah when I read these. Or amen. You have victory over Satan. Amen. There you go. You have victory over tribulation. I like that. You have victory over death. Yes, we will not see death. Oh, well, your flesh is going to die. Yeah, but I'm not. Once this tent gets shed, I'm still walking. And I'm going to be talking with the Most High God. I'm not going to see death. I talked about that a couple weeks ago, what death is. Amen? I won't see it. What does John 5:24 says? He that heareth my words and believe on him that sent me shall not come into condemnation, but they shall pass from death to what? Life. You will not. You passed it. We have victory over death. Amen? Before I get into all the other spirits, I'm going to go to just one, and we're going to finish up with this, and then we're going to start on the other spirits next week. And then, like I said, at the end of the thing, I'm going to bring out some stuff that's, you notice I'm giving you a lot of scriptures to back all this up. And then I'm going to talk about where the evil spirits, how they got here and stuff, different theology, bring in something else to read to you. But if it's not in the Word of God, it's all meaningless. It has to be in the Word of God. Amen? Amen. Let's turn to 1 Samuel 16:14. 1 Samuel 16:14. When you get there, say, amen. Let me take a couple of drinks before you do. Okay. 1 Samuel, way over in the New Testament, Old Testament. Woo. Chapter 16, verse 14. It says, but the Spirit of the Lord. Now, who is that Spirit? We call it what? Say it. Holy Spirit. All right? Holy Spirit. The Holy Ghost. The Holy Spirit. That's what it's called. Ruach in the Hebrew. Spirit. Some say it's breath. God breathed into him and gave him life, the Spirit. Anyways, it says, but the Spirit of the Lord departed from Saul, and what? And an evil spirit from the Lord troubled him. And an evil spirit from who?
the Lord. Did you guys catch that right there? Did you see who troubled Saul? First of all, he took his Holy Spirit out of him because why? Who knows the story? Why did the Holy Spirit God remove from Saul? Because of one word, disobedience. Didn't follow his word. I told you to do this, and you didn't do it. I'm going to remove it from you. And I'm going to allow an evil spirit to come upon you. That evil spirit was bad because every time David came around him, he wanted to kill David. I mean, you know the story. Took a javelin and tried to stick him to a wall. Called David in to soothe this evil spirit by what? Playing worship music on a harp. The worship that Kim and Emma brought to us soothed our spirits. That's why what those two do is a gift from God. It's a talent that God gave them. Do not hide that talent, brother or sister. You have that. It soothes our souls. It brings us to the throne of God. Read that through David doing there. I want you to understand how important you are in a church. How important you are to God. Each one of you, you too, Emma, you too, Kim. It's so important what you two do up here. By bringing us to his throne, because it soothes our spirit. Because now we're not focusing on our problems. We're focusing on only the one we're supposed to be by worshiping him and praising him and listening to the words that you guys are saying. I'm listening to him. I'm listening to the songs. And each time Brother Kim could play this song 100 times, but the Lord's going to still give me something each time he plays it. It's going to be something different. It lined up with today's word, what I heard today. So I want to go there. David in his prayer, Psalms 51, verse 11. You don't have to turn there if you want to write it down. He says, look at this. David, after he did sin, and this wasn't being disobedient. It was, but I mean, it wasn't like God said, hey, go kill the Amalekites. This is David in his own flesh doing lust. He was up. You heard that song, Hallelujah. Have you guys heard that song? I think you like that song. You wanted Josiah to sing it, I think. And he was working on it. Hallelujah. And it's something about David and stuff. I don't know the whole song, but it talks about him being up on there and he saw this beauty. He committed adultery. Okay. And after this is his prayer. But verse 11, look at it. It says, cast me not away from your presence, O Lord, when I fall. When I don't do your will, please cast me not away from your presence. Look what he says. And take not thy Holy Spirit from me. Do you not think that David saw what happened to Saul? And he understood when the Holy Spirit is taken away from him, you turn out like the devil? All Saul wanted to do, and he was very well at it, is trying to kill David. His mind wasn't up on God no more. It was up on nothing but to kill David. He searched him. He followed him. He was so involved in trying to kill David, he didn't even look at God anymore. And we'll get into what he did later. He even went to a witch. Yeah, that's in your Bible. And I'll read it later on. He went to a witch and he summoned up his spirit called a seance. It's in the Bible. We'll get to that. You're going to say, really? I never read that. You will. There's incest in your Bible too. We'll read that. There's a lot of stuff if you just spend time to read it. It's a big, big, big book. And it's full of everything you can think of. Anything you can think of, it's in here. You can say it. And you say, well, go over there. It talks about it. There's nothing new under the sun, beloved. It's all in there. 1 Samuel 16:15, let's read the verse after that. It says, then Saul's servant said unto him, behold, now an evil spirit from God troubles thee. His servants had to tell him, hey, look it, you know what troubles you? An evil spirit from God. It's almost like you should have listened to him. You should have been more obedient when he told you not to do it, but hey, now you got an evil spirit on you. Wow. That's the servants telling him, the king. I read that, I was like, wow. Says it troubled him. It stirred him up unruly and tormented with passion, with envy, with rage, with fear, with despair. and the like. This is what that evil spirit does when it comes upon you. You have despair, you have rage, you have fear. You wonder where fear comes from, it's not of God. You have anger, it's not of God. If you have rage, it's not of God. If you have envy of something, it's not of God. Jesus never walked around with envy of anything. He never said, oh, I like that Mustang and I want that. You never read that. He said, if a man walks 1 mile, you need to walk 2 with him. Matter of fact, you need to give him your coat. If you have 2 of them, take it off and give it to him. He didn't say, take what he has. He said, give him what you have. We have it backwards. We always want give, give, give. No, we want, want, want. We're a want, want world. Come on now. Got to have the next best iPhone. We're all of age here. Kevin might be the youngest in here. But I can guarantee you, I asked some of you older ones, when you were around 15, did you have a cell phone? I don't see a hand coming up. There wasn't even a phone probably when you were there. It was one of those. And you were on a party line. Come on now. Shelby, I know you remember a party line because I remember when I was a kid. But look at everything that comes out new today. We want, we want. The problem is, us grandparents and parents, we give, we give, we give. And we treat God the same way. We want, we want, we want. Not all the time he gives because we want of an evil heart. God says he supplies your needs, what you need to make it through. What you need to walk the walk I called you to walk, I will give it to you. If you have faith with me, you're the one who will walk on water, but have faith in me. The problem is we look around the everything else but him, as Peter did, and he fell. He started to sink. Remember the story? He screamed. All he had to do was still have faith in Jesus, and he would have walked to him. He would have never sunk in the water. But the problem was he didn't listen to the word of God that was standing in front of him. Come to me. Jesus is telling you to come to me today. Walk out and have faith in me and you'll walk on the same water I walk on. Hey, it's solid. Woo-hoo. Bam. Come on now. You know you would want to walk on water. It's just not me. Just think he's standing on water. Because he had faith in the one he was seeing. But what happened to him? He took another step and he took his eyes off the one that said, come to me. Because if he would have kept his eyes on him, he would have walked all the way to him. But instead of walking to him, he took his eyes off of him. And he started worrying about, oh, that's a big wave. I'm going to sink. Here's a fisherman. He ain't scared of water. Come on. He got his eyes on the world and the things around him. What happened to him once he took his eyes off of Jesus? And then what's the first thing he did? Lord, save me. All I told you to do is get out of the boat and walk to me. Now you're asking me to save you. And Jesus did, quickly. Quickly, just reach down and touch his hand. Come on now. That's the God we follow. Peter's eyes wasn't on Christ, but Christ still reached down and still grabbed him and still took him to the other side and still had faith in him because he knew in 10 years or 2 years or 50 days that Peter would be filled with the Holy Spirit and he would be doing his will. And be hung upside down and died because he wasn't right to die as Jesus died. He died because he had boldness. 5,000 people came to the Lord when he was filled with the Holy Spirit. 3.5 years he walked with Jesus and did nothing but followed him and watch all the miracles. But once he was filled with the Holy Spirit, he had the boldness to preach his gospel. And people got saved. Amen. We need to be filled. Evil. It says that evil, this is disguised in a natural and moral. It's two ways, natural and moral. Natural evil is whatever destroys or any way disturbs the perfection of a natural being. In other words, blindness, disease, death. We saw Jesus healed all them that had evil spirits. And then it goes moral. Is the evil that is disagreement between the action of moral agent. The rule of those actions, whatever it be, is termed wickedness or sin. That's your moral. You have the right. You know what's right. God's written it up on your heart. Do not lie. You know not to lie. But yet, how do you feel today? Oh, I feel great. You lied. You hurt. You're broken. You're down. Something's bothering you. Tell the truth. Brother, pray for me. I don't feel good today. Don't come in with a big smile. Oh, I'm doing super. You're lying. Ouch. You never looked at it that way, huh? Don't be caught up into this. Have qualities tending to injure and mischief. That word mischief, interesting. I was just thinking about that right now. A verse came to me in Proverbs. It says, a just man will fall seven times, but the wicked will fall into mischief. Ouch. Wow. I think that's 24 verse 16. Proverbs 24 verse 16. That just came. I was just reading that. So it goes in this, and I'm about finished. It's also this evil spirit is playful and naughty and teasing way, troublesome and irritating. Have you ever been irritated over something? Didn't know why? Come on now, people. We all been irritated. That's the evil guy trying to get you off of God's path. Having bad qualities of a moral kind, wicked, corrupt, perverse, wrong, evil thoughts. Nobody in here has ever had an evil thought, amen? Evil deeds, evil speaking, evil generation. It goes on and on. Unfortunately, unhappy. Is there times that we're unhappy, beloved? Producing sorrow. Is there times we're sorrowful? Distress, injury, calamity, evil tidings, evil arrows, evil days, not good, worthlessness, having a harm, effect as evil beast, evil plant, evil crop. You want me to back that up? A good tree cannot bear forth evil fruit. Matthew 7:18. Whatever's not good is what?
Evil.
Look, I want to be in the goodness of Christ. I want to say this last. I just want to read a couple more verses. You guys okay? It says in Luke 7:21. And in the same hour he cured many of their infirmities and plagues and of evil spirits and of evil spirits. And unto many that were blind he gave sight. He cleansed them of evil spirits. Acts 19, if you want to turn to Acts 19, verse 11. It says, and God wrought special miracles by the hands of Paul. God did miracles through each one of you that spreads his gospel and someone come to know the Lord. Amen. Verse 12 says this, so that from his body were brought unto sick handkerchiefs, aprons, and the disease departed from them. And what? And the evil spirits went out of them. Hallelujah. Look at verse 13. And a certain of the Vandenbog Jews, that means these are wandering Jews. That's what they mean. They're wandering Jews. They did exorcism. These wandering Jews would go around casting out these evil spirits. That's what that is. We have, today they do exorcism. We have branches within communities that will send certain people out to do exorcism. Well, we have the power just in the name of Jesus to cast these out, and we learn that. We don't have to go there with smoke, and we don't have to do this. There was a movie just out about Jesus. What was the name of that movie? You remember that whole series just came out? Chosen. I liked the very first one, and it kind of went downhill to Hollywood after that, but the first one showed Nicodemus going in, trying to cast out the seven spirits out of Magdalene. He was more afraid leaving than he did go in. You can watch the series or that just that one. But he didn't have the power to cast those demons out because she still had them. Only Jesus cast them out. Only Jesus, by the power that's in his name. So it says here, look at this. A certain van of all Jews, exorcism took upon them to call over than that which had evil spirits, the name of the Lord Jesus, saying, we adjourn you by Jesus whom Paul preaches. See, they were listening to Paul, and they saw that Paul was using the name of Christ, and the spirits were leaving. So now these guys said, hey, we're going to do the same thing. We see that works. You know what they're probably thinking? I'll cast that person, demon out of that person, if you give me this. That happens today, still to this day. So anyways, they said this. And I already explained to you, I'm not going to go about the wandering Jews again, but that power did exist. Sometimes, at least, seems implied in Matthew 12:27. It says, if I cast out Beelzebub, if I by Beelzebub cast out devils by whom your children cast them out, that's the wandering Jews, cast them out, therefore they shall be your judges. In Matthew 12:28. But if I cast out devils by the Spirit of God, then the kingdom of God has come upon you. Verse 29. Or else, how can one enter into a strong man's house and spoil his good except he first bind the strong man? And then he spoils his house. In the name of Jesus Christ, we come against him. Verse 30. Is it not with me? He that is not with me, and then he that gathers with me scatters abroad. You have to be with him or you're against him. So I want to finish this Acts. It says, and there was seven sons of Sceva. Seven of them, back to Acts, a Jew, a chief of the priests, which did so. And the evil spirit answered and said unto them, listen to this, to these seven sons that are trying to cast out these demons. Look what it says there in verse 15, an evil spirit answered. That means they can talk. They came into this dimension and they're talking to him and they answered and said, Jesus I know. And Paul I know. But who are you? See, I don't see the covering over you. I don't see you bought with blood. Who are you? That's what they asked the seven. Wow, that's powerful, people. It says, who are the seven? But who are you? What power have you over evil spirits? By what right do you attempt to expel them? The meaning is, you belong neither to Jesus nor Paul. You are not of their party. Or you have no right or authority to attempt to work miracles in that name either. Look at verse 16. I put that in there so you can understand. Verse 16 says that the man whom the evil spirits leapt on overcame them, prevailed against them, so that they fled out of the house naked and wounded. Ouch. And it was known, verse 17, and this was known to all the Jews and Greeks also dwelling in Ephesus. And fear fell on all of them. And the name of the Lord Jesus Christ was magnified. Listen to me. His name was magnified because it's the power of Jesus that cast out demons. Those demons knew who Paul was. And there's verses I was going to read later on. They know who Jesus was. And we'll see those next week. And I want you to see this. You are the child of the Most High God. They know who each one of you are. When you cast out one, if you come against one, all you have to do is say, in the name of Jesus, depart. You don't need to scram. You don't need to argue with him. You don't need to say no more. All you need to say, the Lord Jesus Christ rebukes you. And let it alone, because it's done by the power that's in him. You have no power over them but by his name. You hear what I'm saying? Because you are the child of the Most High God. You are blood bought, sealed by the Holy Spirit. So let's not grieve the Holy Spirit, because you are sealed for that day of redemption. Amen? I hope you learned a little bit more about evil spirits, but where there's still a dumb spirit we got to get to. There's a lot of other spirits we got to get to. That's why I'm taking my time to go through, and everything I'm giving you is nothing but scripture over scripture over scripture to show you this is in the Word of God. It's real. Church, we cannot keep turning our heads to what the enemy is doing out there. He's doing it in our politics. He's doing it in our government. He's doing it in our schools. He's doing it in our ward. He's trying to do it in our household. He's doing it to our families. But we have power in the name of Jesus, and we need to cast them out. Amen. Leave our family alone. Leave our job. I'm at work. I told this to a sister the other day. I'm here because God has kept me here. They can't fire me unless God allows them to fire me. They want me to walk out the door. It's only because God has something else for me. And that's the way I got to start walking from this day on. My money comes from God and God alone, not some business. He owns me. If he opens another door, I'm going to walk through it that no man can shut, because it's God that opened it. And we all need to have that faith in Jesus, faith in my health, faith in my mental capabilities, not allowing the enemy to get up in the playground, the ear gates, the eye gates, the touchy gates that gets us in a lot of trouble. Men, women, all of us, watch what you listen to. Be careful. They come in sheep clothing, but a lot of them are wolves. And they're ravenous wolves. Remember what I'm saying to you. Be careful. Be prayed up. Be filled up. Amen. And I'm talking be filled up with the Holy Spirit. Because a lot of times we listen to ourselves more than we do to God. Let God be God. Amen. And be filled with him. Let's bow our heads. Father, I thank you for your word. I thank you that it's powerful. And I thank you that it's sharper than any two-edged sword. Most of all, I thank you that it's alive. I thank you that it knows my heart and knows my thoughts. And I'm thankful, Father, for who you are in my life. I'm thankful that you speak to me. I'm thankful that you correct me. I'm thankful for my job and my finances and my wife and my family. But Father, teach me my position that's in you. That's the most important thing. You and you alone, Father. I ask that in the name of Jesus. Bless the hearers today, Father, that will open their ear to hear what the Spirit has to say to them, that Holy Spirit. Open their ears to hear the Spirit of God so they can understand, Father, who they're fighting against, who they're wrestling with when they come to these fights and these problems, Father. It's not the person in front of them, it's the enemy that we see not sometimes. Open our eyes, Father, to see that realm. Open our eyes. Give us faith to walk with strength. I pray that, Father, not with a fearful spirit, but with a powerful spirit that's called the Holy Spirit. Bless them again, Father, as we go into the highways and byways and preach your gospel. Open the hearts of the people in the name of Jesus, and we all say, amen. Amen.